Okay, so good afternoon. Welcome to the basic human anatomy course. Most of you are attending this course under the name ANAT1010 Section 1, but probably some online students are also from Section 2 are also attending for their Anatomy 1020 and DEHY 2851. So this course has a lot of students to attend it. My name is Akram Jafar. This course has a lot of things to be done online. So that's why I advise you to go to Brightspace. And the first thing to do on Brightspace is that you view the Getting Started video. Within 15 minutes, you will get a good grasp of the course and how are you going to deal with this course. You can get a very high mark if you just follow the instructions and do the tasks on time. This is my contact information. I welcome you to send me emails, have an appointment, and discuss anything that might arise, or you might send me emails and ask the question, and I will try do my best to answer your question. If not, then we can meet in person. So this is an introduction to human anatomy. What is anatomy? Anatomy is the study of the structure of the human body and related to function. Study of the function is physiology, and you're going, many of you have a physiology course as well, but we are here mainly concerned about studying the structure. But this structure, keeping in mind the function, because the structure changes with the function. It is built, we are built to do certain functions. Organs are built to do certain functions. The word anatomy is derived from Latin. It's ana means up, tomy means cutting. So it's cutting up. It's the same like dissection, to cut apart. And anatomy is studied either by naked eye, so this is gross anatomy, or macroscopic anatomy, or you can study the structure through a microscope, like light microscope or electron microscope. So this is microscopic anatomy, and the other term for it is histology. And histology is part of this course, as well as the gross anatomy. Like, for example, in the next four lectures, we're going to, most of our concentration will be on histology. We are going to study cells and tissues, and then we go higher up into the gross anatomy. And the gross anatomy is studied in two ways. It's either studied as regions, like, for example, you study the abdomen, or you study the upper limb, or you study the head and neck. This is not our approach here in this course. The approach in this course is we study it by systems. So we study the, for example, the musculoskeletal system. So wherever there are bones and muscles, we study them. We study the gastrointestinal system, which is, for example, starting from the mouth in the head, and then the pharynx and the esophagus in the neck, and then esophagus in the thorax, and then we have the stomach and the intestines and the abdomen and the pelvis. So this is systemic anatomy, and this is the way that we're going to approach anatomy in this course. The body is, there are certain levels of structural organization. It starts with chemical level, then higher up cellular level, then higher up tissue, then organ, then system, and then the whole organism. And you can see here that if we start with chemical level, I'm not going to study this, but this is part of the biochemistry, but actually the body is formed of atoms, and these atoms collect together to form molecules. Some of these molecules are organic, some of them are inorganic. Usually the organic molecules are large molecules, as you can see them here, and then these molecules will come together and will form larger and larger molecules. Like, for example, this is a molecule of DNA, or a molecule of protein, or a molecule of lipids. So these are macromolecules. And these macromolecules, the proteins, the lipids, the nucleic acids, the carbohydrates, they will come together, as you see here, to form a cell. This is the cell membrane, which we are going to study next time. And you can see that it is formed of lipid molecules, of protein molecules, and carbohydrate molecules. These large macromolecules come together and form the membrane of a cell. So the next level of structural organization is the cellular level. And this is the cell is the basic structural and functional unit of an organism, the basic structural unit. And when these cells come together, they form a higher level of organization. That is the tissue level. So cells that are almost similar to each other, they have a similar function, and they have a similar embryonic origin, they will produce tissues. They will form tissues. And as we will study them later on in more details, we have four basic types of tissues, as you see them here. So we are going, for example, in lecture 3 and lecture 4 to concentrate on epithelial tissue and connective tissue. And then we will have the nervous tissue in block 2. And then by the end of block 1, we will have the muscular tissue. You can see the four types of tissues here in the body. Some of the tissues are so variable. I'll just give you an example, like the connective tissue. We have the connective tissue that is like the adipose tissue, the fat, but cartilage is a kind of connective tissue. Bone is a kind of connective tissue. Even blood, which is liquid, is a kind of connective tissue. So there are special criteria we are going to define for these tissues as we study them. Then tissues come together to form organs, like, for example, here, the stomach. The stomach is a collection of four types of tissues collected here. So we have the lining of the stomach, which is made of epithelial tissue, and these are the glands that produce the mucus. They produce the hydrochloric acid. So this is epithelial tissue. And then this is covered by muscle fibers, smooth muscle fibers, not like the muscle fibers that we have in the skeleton. And these muscle fibers are required for what we call churning of food, which is one of the functions of the stomach, mechanical digestion of food. And then we have nerves, nervous tissue, supplying these muscles in order to move. Okay? And then we have connective tissue binding all the tissues together. So the four types of tissues, basic tissues, come together and form an organ, which is a higher level of structural organization. And then we have the esophagus, we have the stomach, we have the liver, the intestine. Together, they constitute a system. So we have the digestive system, organs that serve a certain function. And we have these systems in the body. This is the way how we are going to approach anatomy in this course. So in block one, as you can see here, we are going to deal with the histology, the four lectures of two cytology and two histology, we're going to deal with the integumentary system, maybe a difficult name, but it means the skin in one way or another. And then the skeletal system, bones, cartilages, and then the muscular system, skeletal muscles. This is in block one. In block two, we are going to deal with the nervous system and the endocrine system. And in block three, we are going to deal with the other systems, respiratory, cardiovascular, lymphatic, digestive, urinary, and reproductive systems. So these are the systems of the body that together constitute the highest level of organization, and that is the organismic level. And this is the way that we are going to study these systems. Now, in anatomical terminology, usually we use Latin or Greek terminology. So sometimes they might be confusing, but anyway, we have to learn the jargon of anatomy. So for example, here, an ampulla means a spherical flask like this one, which was used by Romans to drink water. But in other words, it means a distended part of the body. So we have here the vas deferens, which is distended here. It is narrow here, but it is distended here. So it forms the ampulla of the vas. And then we have, for example, here a hepatopancreatic ampulla. You can see a distension here. So some distensions in the ducts or of the body are called ampulla, and this is the origin of the name. The other thing that we have to learn about anatomy is the anatomical position. And this is the position that we use it to standardize our descriptions of the anatomical structures and their relations. And this is the anatomical position. It is an unusual position. We have always to visualize the body as standing, and the eyes are looking forwards. The upper limbs are close to the body. In other words, we call adducted. This is a movement of adduction, and this is a movement of abduction. So the arms, the upper limbs are adducted, and the palms are facing forwards. And this is this movement of the forearm. It's called supination and pronation. It's like when you tighten a screw or when you start the engine of the car, you are supinating your forearm, and then the lower limbs are adducted and the toes are forward. So this is, you always imagine the body in the anatomical position. So if, for example, if I am lying down supine in bed and you want to describe my nose, you don't say my nose is superior, it is anterior, because you have to describe me in the anatomical position. is a standardized position. So that is the importance of the anatomy. We have other positions. We have the prone position. We have the supine position. But we always refer in our descriptions to the anatomical position. There are some common and anatomical terms. I mean, many of us know the parts of the body. But these parts of the body, which we usually refer to them in common terms, we have to stop referring to them in common terms in professional language. So, for example, we don't refer to the armpit, we refer to it as the axilla. So these are the terms that we are going to use. The forehead is the frontal region, for example. The cheek is the buccal region. The chin is the mental region, okay? So you can see a lot of these anatomical terms. When you say, my leg hurts, and in professional sense, it means the area between your knee and ankle. This is the leg. It's not the entire lower limb. So the lower limb is formed of a thigh, of a leg, and a foot. When you say my arm is hurting, then you mean the area between the shoulder and the elbow. It's not the entire upper limb, because this is a forearm, and this is the wrist, and this is the hand in anatomical terms. Now, for those of you who would like to participate in Top Hat, this is the time to take the first Top Hat question. And then these are the major directional terms that we have to use. Usually, you can see that they are in the form of pairs. So we have anterior or ventral, which is toward the front, and posterior. You can see here, anterior and posterior. We have medial and lateral. So medial is toward the median plane of the body. And lateral is away from the median plane. So many of these terms, proximal and distal, like for example here, proximal is close to the, usually use it for the limbs. So the proximal is close to the root of the limb, and distal is away from the root of the limb. So the elbow is distal to the shoulder, but the elbow is proximal to the wrist. I like the t-shirt of this professor. Can you read? Everything I say will be in the exam. That was the t-shirt in her first lecture. And then we have the planes and sections. So we divide, usually we use three planes to section the body. And these planes are perpendicular to each other, like that. So we have the, for example here, the sagittal plane, the one in red, the sagittal. And this divides the body into right and left sides. And then we have the coronal plane, or the frontal plane, divides the body into posterior and anterior. And then we have the horizontal plane, which divides the body into upper and lower parts. So we usually refer to these planes when we deal with descriptions of the body. The sagittal plane, if it is exactly in the midline, then it is called the median plane. So it divides the body into two equal halves. If it is a little bit away from the midline, then it is a parasagittal or sagittal plane. You can use sagittal for both. But sometimes you will find terms like parasagittal or median plane. They are all sagittal planes. And this is the origin of the term of the frontal or coronal. You can see here, this is a superior view of the skull showing you a suture. We are going to talk about this in more details in the lectures on the skull. It's called the coronal suture. Coronal because this is where the crown is put on the head. So that's why it's called coronal suture, and from it comes the coronal planes that divide the body into anterior and posterior parts. And then this is the skull of a newborn, showing you that these sutures are accompanied by soft spots on the head, probably if you have sisters or brothers younger than you. And for the newborn, you will find that there are soft spots on the head. And this arrangement together will give here, will give the impression of an arrow, like an arrow. And arrow is sagitta, so it's called the sagittal plane, and the suture is the sagittal suture, and from it came the sagittal plane. Very difficult nomenclature, but this is the way that they use. In the body, there are cavities. You can see the yellow cavity here. This is the dorsal body cavity, and this is the ventral body cavity. The dorsal body cavity is subdivided into two cavities, into a cranial cavity that contains the brain and a spinal cavity here, or a spinal canal or vertebral canal, which contains the spinal cord. And these, both of them, are part of the dorsal body cavity. And then we have the ventral body cavity, which is located anteriorly, and it is divided into a thoracic cavity in the chest and abdominal pelvic cavities. These are separated by the diaphragm, abdominal, thoracoabdominal diaphragm. It's a muscular sheet. We are going to study the details later on, and it's very important in respiration. And this divides the thoracic from the abdominal pelvic cavities. The abdominal pelvic cavities, as you can see, the green area here, is they are continuous with each other. And the plane of division between them is an imaginary plane. It is not, there's no diaphragm separating the abdominal cavity from the pelvic cavity. The thoracic cavity is further subdivided into a cavity that contains the heart, encloses the heart, so it's called peri around cardium, cardium, cardiac relating to heart, so pericardial cavity, and another cavity which is called the pleural cavity, two pleural cavities, one on either side, that enclose the lungs. And this is the last slide to show you that we use certain landmarks on the body to refer to structures in the body. So these landmarks, for example, in the abdomen, when we want to refer to the abdomen, for example, let's say you want to report a pain or you want to report a lump in the abdomen or an enlarged organ in the abdomen, you either refer to it as quadrants. Imagine that the abdomen is divided into four quadrants, so upper right, upper left, and lower right quadrants. You will say the patient has pain in the right upper quadrant. This is a way of doing it. Or you divide the abdomen into nine abdominal regions, which is more specific and more to the point. And you can see here that there are two vertical lines and two horizontal lines to divide the abdomen into right hypochondrium, left hypochondrium, epigastrium, right lumbar, left lumbar, umbilical, right inguinal, left inguinal, and suprapubic region. Thank you.